As you can see, it's 8 to 11% incidence of lumbar spinal stenosis in the United States. It is the most common reason for spine surgery in the older patients. And obviously this will all have a big financial impact and lost work hours, and it reaches billions and billions of dollars each year in the US. I know billions of dollars are not that much anymore nowadays. Now we talk about trillions, but for me, it's still a lot of money, billions. So next slide. The anatomy of the spine we're going to discuss. Next slide. Just some simple terms in the hope that you will better understand this presentation. You need to know what the foramen is. The foramen is an opening at the spine where the nerve comes out. And in spinal stenosis, that foramen can narrow, and that's called foraminal stenosis. So there's not enough room for the nerve where it exits, and you have to sometimes have to treat that. Next slide. You have five lumbar segments, and spinal stenosis is mostly between the L4-5 and L3-4 segments. Next slide. Next slide. So you have the vertebral body, and in between the vertebral bodies, you have the disc space. The disc space can collapse and degenerate and also give you all kinds of problems. Next slide. Then you have the spinous process, and the next slide. And the space in between the spinous process, which is called the interspinous space. That's important. Go back one more time. That's important because with the treatment, surgical treatments, one of the approaches is that you go in between those spinous processes to decompress the spinal canal. Yeah, next slide. So in a healthy person, you have a healthy disc, you see the openings. Unfortunately, I cannot point to anything with these Zoom or how do you, these meetings, but you can see the nerve coming out through the foramen. There's no compression. The ligaments, which is the yellow structure in the back, is not enlarged. The bones are not enlarged, so this is all healthy. So the vertebrae provide support for your head and body, and the disc, they act as shock absorbers. And then the vertebra protects the spinal cord with all the nerves, and the nerves have space in this case, like I told you before, and are not pinched. In contrast to the sick, that's the next slide. So in the stenotic patient, you see that the intervertebral disc is degenerated and bulging out. The ligaments in the back, the yellow ligament it's called, the flavin ligament is enlarged. The bones are enlarged, and this all causes narrowing for the nerve. So in the central canal, as we call it, it's narrow, and where the nerves exit, so the foramen stenosis, you can see this pinching of the nerve. So this stuff happens when we get older. Now, it does not mean that if you have stenosis, that you automatically have symptoms. So that comes later, but we should not treat pictures. We should treat symptoms that you have. Now, the symptoms are pain and numbness going down the back of your legs. And this is with or without back pain, but the main symptoms are pain and numbness in the back and the legs. Yeah, next slide. This is what I all discussed, right? You get a narrowed spinal canal, the flavum ligament is thickened, the bone is thickened, and that causes compression of the nerve structures. Yeah, next slide. Now, if you stand, you extend, so you go backwards. When you stand up, you go backwards with your spine, and that results in a further decrease of the diameter of the central canal and a further decrease of the opening where the nerve comes out, so foramen stenosis. Now, if you bend forward, flexion, you open up your spinal canal and you provide room for the nerve. Therefore, patients with spinal stenosis, they complain about pain with walking and standing. And as soon as they sit down, it usually improves. And you see why that's the case. Yeah, next slide. So what's the classic presentation of lumbar spinal stenosis? That's called neurogenic claudicatio, which is a dull or aching back pain that spreads to the legs and that is associated with numbness or weakness. And it occurs again with walking and standing. Sitting relieves the symptoms, and you can have associated weakness or loss of balance and a decreased endurance for physical activity. So this is the classic presentation. The most important differential diagnosis is what we call vascular claudication. So those patients have a problem with the blood vessels. And they exert symptoms when they are walking, but as soon as they stand still, the symptoms go away. So that's the important differential diagnosis. Next slide. Now here you see it, standing provokes the symptoms with pain and other symptoms down the legs. And classical, the patients say, well, if I lean over my shopping cart, that really helps. And that's true because then they're opening up their spine and provide room for the nerves. And again, sitting down also improves the symptoms because again, you're flexing and you're opening up your spine. So this demonstrates nicely the classic symptoms. Next slide. Now, obviously, if you don't move anymore, and especially when you're older, this can lead to all kinds of problems. You can become obese, you can get general physical deterioration, psychological problems, and worsening of any other comorbidities that you have, such as diabetes, for example, or high blood pressure. Next slide. Now, what are the radiological characteristics? And in this case, I put an MRI up because that demonstrates it the best. On the left, you see three pictures. And then the most left one is what we call a sagittal approach or view of the spine, where you see the spinal canal. But if you look at the not the lowest, but the one above, you see there's a lot of black in the middle. That's the spinal stenosis. And you see it circled on the right side, on the right picture. And that's spinal stenosis. There's no room for the nerves to flow through the central canal. On the left, you also see what we call axial cuts through the MRI. Now, on the bottom one, you see the canal is nice and round. It's open with spinal fluid, which is the white stuff. And then you see the gray dots, which are the nerves. Now, if you look above, Now it's becoming a triangular structure, and I cannot differentiate anymore where the separate nerves are, where the spinal fluid is. So that's what we call spinal stenosis. Next slide. Now, what are treatment options? There are a lot of treatment options, which we will discuss in detail during this presentation. But as I said in the beginning, the treatment of spinal stenosis is based on clinical symptoms and not, and I want to stress that, not on radiological abnormalities. If we make an MRI of people that are age 16 and older, 60, the over majority are going to show significant abnormalities on the MRI. And then you're going to ask them like, oh my goodness, you must be in terrible pain. They're like, what? No, I have nothing. So therefore, you need to look at the clinical symptoms before you start treating anything showing on the MRI. And the repetition or the clinical symptoms are neurogenic claudications or pain radiating down the legs and with or without back pain. Yeah, next slide. Now, what are your treatment options? On the left, you see non-operative care, which we are not going to discuss today, and which is reserved for milder symptoms, consists of epidural injections, physical therapy, Tylenol, anti-inflammatory drugs, etc., etc. Now, if you move towards the right, you get moderate to severe symptoms, and that's where you get into the surgical category. Now, the surgical category can be the traditional open surgeries, which is either a laminectomy, which is a decompression, with or without a fusion, depending on the symptoms you have. Basically, depending if you're having a lot of back pain with it, or are there any anatomical deformities that need to be corrected. And then today, we're going to discuss the minimally invasive options. Next slide. Now, why do we want to get smaller and smaller, or at least destruct less anatomical structures? Therefore, I think we have to look at the definition, and then automatically you understand what the advantages are of the minimally invasive spine surgery. So the definition of minimally invasive spine surgery is less invasive surgery. It is less exposure spine surgery. So in other words, it's a specialization in spine surgery that provides strategically conceived approaches to the spinal pathology through careful planned surgical corridors to minimize collateral normal tissue damage while providing adequate exposure and access to the target pathology. In other words, what we used to do in open procedures, we now do all through small windows without destructing all the anatomy, but still getting the same outcomes. And so those are the advantages of minimally invasive spine. You have, because of that, because you're not opening a lot, you have a significant reduction in infections. You have no blood loss. I cannot remember, my last blood transfusion was with an open surgery. I haven't given any blood transfusions in the last, 15 years. Hospital stay is usually faster with a faster recovery. And you have similar outcomes. I mean, the last one is important. And you can make beautiful surgeries and do it all small and what you want. But if the outcomes in the end are not the same as the open procedure, you should not do it. So that's an important one, obviously. Yeah, next slide. So what is the goal of the surgical treatment in general? And in this case, minimally invasive spine surgery in particular. The goal is obviously to relieve the pressure of the spinal cord and the nerves by increasing the area around the spinal canal and neuroforamen. So if you look at the picture on the right, you see that it's a triangle, the form of the spinal canal. So you want to make that round again, that it looks round like it's normal. And where the nerves come out, you want to open it up. That's called a foramenotomy. You want to make sure that the nerves have enough space. Okay? So you can achieve that through open or minimally invasive approaches. And in minimally invasive surgery, you can either do that through a direct decompression, which means you are removing ligaments and bone, etc., to directly decompress the nervous structures. Or you can do it by indirect decompression. And that last part is specific for minimally invasive spine surgery. And what I mean by indirectly is that without removing any bone, ligaments, without destroying the anatomy, you are placing either screws or spacers in such a way that you are opening up the disc space and the foramen, or realign the spine so you restore the anatomical features of the spine. And in that way, when you restore the normal anatomy, you decompress the nervous structures, but again, without actually decompressing them by actually seeing them. So that's a really, really big advantage of minimally invasive spine surgery. Now, the type of minimally invasive approach is depending on the clinical presentation. So as I said before, is it only leg pain or is there also a lot of back pain involved? Are there symptoms in one leg or are there in both legs? And then it depends on the complexity of the pathology that the patient presents with. Is it one level stenosis, which is rather simple for the surgeon? Or are we having multiple levels where there is stenosis? Or are we dealing with a slip, which is which we call a spondylolisthesis, where one vertebral body slips forward and causes spinal stenosis? Or are we dealing with a deformity, which is a scoliosis, a curve in the spine? Or does the patient have previous surgeries done, so you don't want to go back through all that scar tissue? Or does have a patient a combination of all of the above? Okay, now the more complex, the more I like to do minimally invasive spine surgery, because then you really have your advantages. Next slide. Yeah, so here you see an example for direct decompression on the left. You see the bones are removed in the middle. You see the nervous structure under there with the nerves coming out. So that's a direct decompression. This is what we call a laminectomy or a laminotomy. You guys can still hear me okay? Yeah, okay.
Yep.
And then on the right, you see the indirect decompression. Now the lowest disc space is completely collapsed. And because of the collapse, the opening where the nerve comes out, the foramen, is also collapsed. Now on the right, I placed an interbody device and you see that I increased the disc height. And because I increased the disc height, I automatically opened up that foramen. So the nerve that comes out of there suddenly has space without removing any bones, ligaments, you name it. So that's an example of indirect decompression. So personally, I like to tailor the surgeries to the patient. And the type of surgery, again, is dependent not only on the patient, but also on the surgical experience, with the surgeon's experience with certain approaches. But again, in my case, and I'm talking about my practice in this presentation, I like to tailor every procedure towards the patient, because there are multiple solutions, surgical solutions to spinal stenosis. Yeah, next slide. Now, minimally invasive approaches we can divide by the method of decompression. I said direct and indirect. Now on the right, you see the direct decompressions. The first one, and we're going to discuss them all. We're going to discuss them all, but the first one is called tubular decompression, so through a tube, and this involves no fusion. And this is luckily the most frequent type of procedure. Now, if there are other anatomical abnormalities, then you're getting into the fusion part too. So the second one is called a minimally invasive transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion, called TLIF. Then another approach, and we're going to see all of them, is a medialized midline approach with cortical screws. Cortical screws are screws that are aiming from inside to outside instead of the classical outside to inside, and that's why you can make really small incisions. I will discuss it. And then another midline approach where I put what's so-called facet pedicle screws in, and that's especially reserved for the elderly population. On the right, you see the indirect methods that I perform. The first one is called an oblique lumbar interbody fusion, an OLIF, also called a DLIF or an XLIF, where you come more from the side. And then the last is an oblique lateral lumbar interbody fusion. I know a lot of names, but I'm going to discuss them in each category. So yeah, let's do the next slide. Now the advantage, as I said before, the advantage of minimally invasive approaches increase with the complexity of the pathology. On the left top, you see a one-level spinal stenosis. So in that case, it doesn't really matter. You want to open it up through a tube, you want to open it up open with a small midline incision, whatever the surgeon is comfortable with. This is not, should not be a difficult surgery, should be a day surgery, should be out the same day. Now on the right top, you see that there are multiple levels that have spinal stenosis. I count three. Now in this case, if I have to make a big midline incision to decompress all of that, or I can do it through a small tube where I have a half inch incision and decompress all these levels, that's a great advantage, obviously. Now we're getting into the advantages of minimally invasive spine surgery. The left bottom one, you see, that's called a spondylolisthesis. One of the vertebral bodies is slipped forward and pushed the disc out backwards and causing spinal stenosis. Now in that case, you can either decide to do it open and remove all the bone from posteriorly from the back, decompress the spine, probably put screws in because there's instability, and call it a day. Or in my case, and I'll show you that later, I can put a indirect decompression. So I put a spacer in where I restore the anatomy, and that automatically will decompress the spinal structures, and I don't need to disrupt any anatomical structures. The same is true for the right side, the right bottom. Up here you see a scoliosis, a curve in the spine, and those I can correct minimally invasive, again through a small incision, where I put all kinds of spacers in, and then followed by screws in the back that I all insert through small incisions in the back. So again, the bigger the pathology, the more advantage you get from minimally invasive spine surgery. Next slide. So now we're going to discuss them category by category. So first we have the simple decompression without fusion, which is called the tubular decompression for lumbar spinal stenosis. Next slide. So there you see, you make a small incision on the back of the patient, then you put that tube through and you land up on the what we call the lamina. And then you perform what we call a laminotomy. And you see that on the pictures on top, those are MRI images. On the left, you see the spinal stenosis with the triangle form. And on the right, you see that the bone is removed and that the spinal canal has its a circular form again. What you can also see in that image is that the patient was decompressed both sides, but from one side approach. So you open it up on one side where your tube goes in, you drill the bone away, and then you can angle your tube outwards and decompress the contralateral side. And again, this becomes very interesting when you have multiple levels of stenosis. And now this is a real advantage. You don't have to open the spine up completely. Yeah, next slide. Next slide. Yeah. Here you see a morbidly obese patient. You see the patient is quite large. And you can understand that this is a major advantage. Instead of working this deep in the patient, now you put a tube in there and you can perform the procedure through a very small opening, as demonstrated in the pictures. And the top right picture where you see a simple Band-Aid over the incision, which is quite amazing. I'm always amazed by it. Yeah, next slide. The next one, the MIST lift, the transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion. Personally, I do not use those that much anymore, but I do want to mention it. It's usually where there is a significant component of back pain. That's where you get the fusion part in addition to leg pain due to nerve compression. Now, the TLIF, what you do is you remove, look at the red circle, you remove basically one joint on one side. And when that's done, you have you can decompress all the nervous structures, and then you clean out the disc and you put a spacer in there. Now, again, you can do that open, or you can do that in a minimally invasive approach. And that's what you see on the bottom left, the open approach where the muscles are ripped. Wow, I didn't want to use those terms, ripped. I mean, basically where the muscles are dissected off the bone, but you understand you have a much wider exposure compared to the right side where you see there's a tube and everything is done through this little tube, including the placement of the spacer, the cage. And also the screws, because you need four screws. Those are all placed what we call minimally invasive through small incisions. Next slide. On the left, the tube. In the middle, you see a laminectomy, really large exposure. And then on the right, you see the incisions for a minimally invasive TLIF. Yeah, next slide. Now, a lot of words. Basically, a midline approach where I put two screws in, two transfacet facet pedicle vertebral body screws. Yeah, next slide. So you can suffer from what we call the spondylolisthesis, as I said before, where there is a slip of the spine. And because of the slip, the canal is narrowed and you display symptoms of spinal stenosis. Now that slip can either be what we call stable, so it's not moving, or it's unstable where you move. Now in the elderly population, you're usually dealing with a much stiffer spine than in the younger patient. So the chances of slippage are less frequent. Now in those patients, I perform this procedure that I'm going to discuss. So instead of the standard treatment where you remove all the bone and then you put big, large screws in, so again, a larger incision with more destruction, what I try to do is a small midline incision where I perform my laminotomy, where I do the decompression of the spinals of the nervous structures. And then I place two screws, and I'll show you the next pictures, that go through the joints and basically lock those joints down in an attempt to prevent slippage later on. Okay, so in the elderly populations, the standard of care can be too invasive. And you want to balance the morbidity with the greatest symptomatic improvement. And therefore, I have this in my surgical armamentarium. Next slide. So what I said, it's a great technique for spondylolisthesis that is not moving. So a stable spondylolisthesis. And it cannot, the spondylolisthesis cannot be too much. We have gradations in those, a grade 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is mostly for a grade 1, sometimes a grade 2. So it's performed through a minimal excess midline approach. It's safe in the elderly, especially in the elder population. And it's less invasive, obviously, than a standard fusion. It has very good outcomes with minimal surgical morbidity. Now here you see those two screws that I'm talking about, how they're being placed, and you see they're going from the inside also to the outside, and therefore you can get rather small incisions in the midline. Next slide. Now another midline technique is with those cortical pedicle screws, where I discussed before, where the screws are going from inside to outside. Some are still next
trying to figure it out. For the most part, it may be doing what.
So the definition of this, I'll read it. It's a less invasive method of achieving posterior fixation and fusion that medializes the surgical approach and limits the exposure to the lateral margin of the articular process. So what I'm trying to say, it's a midline approach, but because I'm screwing from inside to outside, I don't have to expose all the bones. And therefore you can come to smaller incisions. Because the screws are going, as you can see in the bottom picture up here, because the screws are going from inside to outside, so away from the nervous structures, it's a safe technique with preservation of the neural elements. Again, it's a single small midline incision. And because you're not using any tubes and you have the familiar anatomy, every surgeon should be able to do this. They're not restricted by tubes, because everything you do through tubes, and the more complex you get, the more experience the surgeons need to have and the more possible complication you can get. So this is a good technique for every surgeon, but they can limit their exposure of the patient, of the anatomy, basically. So, yeah, next slide. So here you see how these screws are placed. So they're going from, you see the drill on the top, the top left image, that's a drill. That's my starting point. And then on the image next to it, you see the trajectory of the screws and how they're going through the pedicle. That's a bone structure. That's why they're called pedicle screws. Okay, so midline incision followed by exposure of the bony elements, and then you screw from medial to lateral instead of from lateral to medial on your x-rays. And then on the lateral x-ray, you screw from the bottom, from what we call from caudal to cranial, so from bottom to top. Next slide. So this technique is indicated for every, can be applied to every patient where some form of fusion is needed in addition to spinal stenosis. So I want to give you some patient examples. In this case, this patient, in my opinion, needed an L4 to S1 fusion. The L5 S1 disc was significantly degenerated. So what I did is I performed that TLIF first, a transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion, where I put a cage in L5S1. I performed a decompression at L4-5 and L5S1. And then I put those screws in from medial to lateral. And you can see that the incision is, what is it? 3.5 centimeter? I think so. 3.5 centimeter. And the fun part in this case, I remember in this case, I actually also made a trajectory one level higher just to see if I can make that. So, and I could. So through this incision, if I wanted to, I could have done a three-level fusion and decompression. Now compare it with a normal incision, that would normally be at least, 2-3 inches. Yeah, next slide. Now this is another example. This patient had a slip, so a spondylolisthesis, but she didn't really have back pain, but the slip was moving. So I needed to have some form of fixation, and I thought that her disc height was preserved at L4-5. So I didn't want to mess with the disc. So what I did is I performed a decompression in the midline, and then again I pointed those screws outwards, and that's how I reduced. You can see that the spondylolisthesis on the bottom picture left is basically gone. So the slip is basically gone. And on the bottom right, you can see in the middle, I wish I could point it for you, but that's where the bone is all gone. So that's where the decompression was performed. And so this is how I treated the spondylolisthesis with stenosis at L4-5 in this patient. Now again, these surgeries, they can be performed in day surgery or one night stay. But that's that's a huge improvement. Next slide. So we're going from smaller to a little bit bigger to bigger to biggest. Okay, so this is a bigger surgery, but still, again, minimally invasive. And now we're going to the indirect decompression techniques that I discussed before. So they seem bigger, but in the end, because you're not destructing any bone, ligaments, and so on, these patients do fantastic. So this is called the oblique lumbar interbody fusion. Let's go to the next slide. So what do you do in those patients? They laying on their side, as you can see, the left side is up. You see the incision marked. I don't know if you can see it, the purple incision in the left lower abdominal quadrant. That's the incision. And this is a great technique for restoring the anatomy by increasing the disc height, which will automatically increase the foraminal height where the nerves are coming out. And this way you can align the spine, so you can reduce your spondylolisthesis or you can correct the curve, okay? So it depends solely on indirect decompression. You can treat the levels L2 to S1 with a small incision in the left lower abdominal quadrant. And as I said to you, I already said what is the last sentence. So patient on the left side, and the bottom picture shows you with the big purple arrow shows you where I go in. To the left of that purple arrow, that's a muscle that's called the psoas muscle. I enter right in front of that psoas muscle on the spine, and the spine is that round gray structure. And then I take out the disc from one side all the way to the other side. I take out a rectangle. And then something like this, let me see if I can show it. Something like this goes in there, all filled with bone. This is called a cage. So there goes, let me see, I can demonstrate a little bit. So the patient is on its side, and then this cage goes in from one side all the way to the other side. Now you understand, if you have a scoliosis and I put a cage in from one side, automatically that will correct. Now there are two other round structures to the right of the arrow, and those are big blood vessels. So you want to stay away from that. Luckily, I've never done anything crazy to those, and I want to keep it that way. Next slide. Here you see the several steps of this procedure. Again, patient on the left side. I made my incision. Several tubes are going down there, and then eventually the retractor is in. On the right side, you see the image where the retractor is in, and I have an instrument up there to see where I am at the disc space. Yeah, next slide. Now these slides demonstrate, so I already did the disc preparation, everything is done, and these slides show you that the cage is going in. So the top left is the cage holder, and also on the bottom left. And then on the bottom right, the images, you see the cage is going in on the top. It starts, it's halfway in, you see that marker sitting, and then look at the bottom, you see that the marker now is all the way towards the other side. So the whole implant is in. And then finally, when the implant is in, I have to add those four screws. You can see that on the radio, on the in the middle images, where it puts all these four screws in, all again, two small images, incisions, I mean. Yeah, next slide. Another, this is a patient example where somebody had a scoliosis. So now you would say, well, you have the scoliosis. Why don't you just decompress those nerves and don't put any screws in? That is a possibility, but the experience is that if you only do what we call a simple decompression, these patients are good for maybe 3 months, and then they come back because the scoliosis just got a little bit worse again, and there is recurrent nerve compression. So therefore, in my opinion, the best treatment would be to minimally invasive correct the scoliosis, which you can see on the right side. I inserted three cages and screws, and on the bottom right image, you see that the scoliosis is completely corrected. Next slide. This is another example. This patient had previous surgery done. He had a multi-level laminectomy done from, L2 all the way to L5, not by me. So I don't like to go back into that scar tissues if there's still a problem. Now, this patient had intractable back pain and signs of neurogenic claudication with radiating pain on his leg. And so I thought that an indirect decompression would be the best option for this patient. So again, without going throughout previous scar tissue, I gave him a small incision on his left side, as I showed you before. I inserted three cages again in this case, and then put the screws in, all three small incisions, to correct his scoliosis and to indirectly decompress his nervous structures. Next slide. Now, the last option I want to discuss is the so-called OLLIF, so the double L. Go to the next slide. And that uses a small triangle. It's called the Kinband triangle. And I go right through the image on the right bottom. Now, you see that the nerve is coming out through that foramen, as I discussed before. And then there is a triangle between the bone and that nerve. And that's a very, very tiny area. But you can find that area and then through that little area, put cages in again, so spacers, and indirectly decompress the spinal structures. Now this, for this case, the patient is laying on his belly, so he's in what we call in prone position. You make a tiny incision, about 1 centimeter, which is about this big. And you see it where it's made on the top image. And then the green line is the approach. And this procedure has very short surgical times. And short, if I tell you that I can do a 2 or 3 level fusion in just over an hour, compared to traditional 3 level fusions, well, they range from 3 hours to some surgeons do 8 hours about them. Yeah, so that's a huge improvement. And again, a great technique for restoring the anatomy by increasing the disc height, the foramenal height, and aligning of the spine, just as the previous technique I discussed with you. Again, solely depending on indirect decompression. This one I can also do in the thoracic spine. So not only lumbar, but also thoracic spine. Same indications, so a collapsed disc, a slip of the spine, or a curve in the spine, or a combination of all, where you want to get an indirect decompression. The disadvantage, as you can understand, I'm going right really close to that nerve, is that there is a higher rate of nerve irritation. The patient can have leg pain, and that can persist for weeks sometimes. In the over majority, that goes away, but again, do you want to, if I mentioned it to you before the surgery, you may accept it. But there, it's bothersome if you have that pain for so many weeks. But the good news is that it will usually go away. Next slide. Yeah, so here you see the surgical steps for this procedure. So the first one is targeting, and that's the top right picture. So with an electric probe, I go in, and then I stimulate, and I want to go into that triangle. And if the stimulation tells me there's no nerve, then I get a tube, a small tube in there, which is the access channel. And you see that the tube is advanced into the disc space. That is the second picture I have on. And then when you have your access channel, then through that tube, you have several instruments to clean out the disc. And when your disc preparation is done, then you advance bone graft in there because you need to get a fusion, which is done with bone. So you put that in there. And then finally, the implant is inserted into the disc space, which you can see on the bottom image. So those are the four steps. Yeah, next. So one clinical example, 70-year-old obese female. Again, she had a previous decompression done. So again, I don't like to go to previous scar tissues. She has diabetes and she has pain with walking and standing. And on top of that, she has continuous back pain across the lumbar spine. On exam, she also has some weakness of her muscles, a grade 4 out of 5. The grade goes go from 1 to 5. So 4 out of 5, so she has mild weakness of what we call the iliopsoas and the dorsiflexor, so the foot, so she has a little drop foot. Yeah, next slide. Now these are images, and you see on the L4-5, so you have the bottom disc, L5 is 1, it's a great height, looks fine. If you go on top, you see a little slip at L4-5. The L4 vertebral body has moved a little bit forward and causes spinal stenosis of the spinal canal. And then on L3-4, you see there's a disc bulge, and I don't have the cuts to the axial spine, but there is also severe spinal stenosis at L3, L4. CT scan on the right side. So yeah, next slide. Now these are the images before surgery. What I do in the patients with what we call the spondylolisthesis, I do x-rays. I bend them forward and backwards. In her case, it moves. I see a slip increasing when she moves forward. The slip gets worse at L4-5. So it's a sign of instability. So I have to perform some form of fusion. Again, there are multiple techniques to do this, but in my case, in her case, 70 years old, you know, some morbidities, I thought this would be a good case to perform that OLLIF. Preoperatively, I look closely at where the nerves are running because I told you higher chance of a temporary nerve pain. So I want to make sure that the nerves are free. And I think this is a good candidate. So next slide. So the indication, neurogenic claudicatio with back pain due to an L4-5 spondy with spinal stenosis and an L3-4 spinal stenosis. Yeah, next slide. Now, these are the images, the post-op images. You see on the right side, which is a side view, and if you look at the bottom spacer, you see that the spondylolisthesis is completely gone. It's completely reduced. And then the picture on the left, you see where the cages are situated, and then again, the screws inserted from L3 to L5 bilaterally. Yeah, next slide. I think these are all the surgical techniques. Again, I want to stress to you that every surgeon has different approaches and different techniques, or only one technique. Some you will go in and they say, oh, this is what I do. Why? Well, this is what I've been doing for 20 years and I have good results. Okay. But this is my view on this. And again, I tailor it to the patient. So are you a candidate? I don't really care much about age. Sometimes I get patients in the office and they say, am I not too old? I don't think so, especially with these minimally invasive techniques. You can treat really old patients. Sorry, I don't know how old the patients are. that are watching this presentation, but you know what I mean. Now, do you have pain or weakness in the legs with the classic presentation? I have to tell you, though, if you have foramen stenosis, so where the nerve comes out, you may have a whole, not the classic presentation of pain with walking and standing. You may be complaining about one leg pain only. That's worse when you walk up the stairs or lay in bed. So that's, for example, foramen stenosis. But if you have the classic symptoms and confirmed diagnosis of lumbar spinal stenosis on imaging, then you are a candidate. Yeah, when you have exhausted your conservative treatments, and for you, this is a debilitating condition. If you say, hey, I can still walk 10 miles and then I get pain in my leg, should I do it? My opinion, I don't think so. Yeah? But that's all up to you. Next slide, is there anything else? Yeah, so what do we have in the minimally invasive spine center of New England? I think we have a solid experience of minimally invasive techniques and approaches to treat the lumbar spine. I mean, that's what we're talking about, lumbar spinal stenosis, but the same is true for the thoracic spine or the cervical spine. Again, I'm able to perform simple, complex, revision spinal surgeries, and all in a minimally invasive approach. I also obviously know the open approaches, okay? The experience allows to deliver surgeries tailored to the individual patient, and I think that's very important. And because of those minimally invasive techniques, my practice showed a large shift from inpatient surgeries to ambulatory surgeries or hospital stays of less than 23 hours. So there's not only an advantage in the normal patient, what is the normal patient, but in the normal patient, but even a greater advantage in complex cases and in obese and the elderly population. Now, I said before, there's a reduction in infections, blood loss, pain, and recovery. And I think this is the end of the presentation. And I'm looking forward to questions. And let's see what we have.
Thank you, Dr. Pennings. We received a few questions. I know we're coming up on time, but a few that came in. What happens to spinal stenosis if left untreated?
If it left untreated, first of all, usually nothing bad is going to happen. So patients may be afraid, like, am I going to get into a wheelchair if I don't treat this? The answer is usually no. So the degeneration is a continuous process. So the spinal stenosis may get worse on your MRI, but it doesn't mean that you're clinically getting worse. It doesn't mean that if I don't treat it, I'm gonna get neurological deficits and this is the end, I have to do it. The answer is no. Obviously, if you develop, I mean, there's a small subset of patients that may develop neurological deficits. Obviously, they need surgery at that time. But usually that will go really, really slow. So you're not with your back against the wall, and it's really usually a matter of quality of life improvement. So it's up to you when you decide, I need to have something done, or hey, I can live with this, I continue to do this. Does that answer the question?
Yes, I think so. Another question that came in, what if you have been diagnosed with spinal stenosis and arthritis?
Well, arthritis is just a general term that doesn't say anything. We all get arthritis, as I said before. If you take an MRI of me, of my lumbar spine, I'm sure I'm going to have arthritis. So that doesn't tell me anything. Again, it's a clinical diagnosis. So you need to show a clinical diagnosis associated with spinal stenosis. Arthritis by itself, which usually stands for excessive ligaments formation, bone formation, can give you spinal stenosis. But arthritis by itself, it's a term that you basically should ignore. If somebody tells you you have arthritis, you say, okay, thank you, that's great. Well, what do you want me to do with it? They're nothing, because it's basically a normal process that we're all going to get.
How about, so I know you mentioned age earlier. A few people have mentioned, are they too old to be operated on? Is there a set age that, you know, it's too late to have surgery?
So let me start with the last one. It's never too late to get the surgery, especially when you have pain. That's independent of time. Again, so waiting with it is not going to hurt you. You may hear that sometimes that they're saying, well, if you wait, you're going to get permanent nerve damage. I have not seen that in any clinical studies that that's true. In fact, there was a good study, a prospective randomized study in the New England Journal for a long time ago, where they looked at herniated discs. And we used to tell patients, well, if you have a herniated disc and you wait too long, you're going to get nerve damage. Well, the study showed that it didn't matter. If you waited 1 month or 2 years, that had no influence of nerve damage. So I think that's the question to the last portion, too late. And then age related, the answer is no, unless, I mean, if you have so many comorbidities, there may be other issues. You're in an oxygen tank the whole day, and if you take one step, you're completely out of breath. Well, then we may have to, you know, be careful. Or you have significant osteoporosis and you need a fusion. Well, that may be limiting the options you have. But age by itself should not be a limiting factor. I think my oldest patient I operated doing a simple decompression, it was either 96 or 101. And then you may say, well, are you out of your, you know what? Well, this patient was in a wheelchair, could not walk anymore from so much pain. And we discussed it. I said, well, we know if you're that old and you sit in a wheelchair, you're gonna die. Because if you're at that age and you're not moving around anymore, that's the end of you. And she fully understood that. So I did a simple decompression. I remember it, simple decompression, went home the same day. And I think that was a good indication because it worked out well. Maybe I was lucky.
Great. A few more questions. What is the downtime after surgery? When can I drive or go back to work?
So there's a difference between non-fusion and fusion. If you have a non-fusion procedure, so a laminotomy, like I showed through the tube, where you have small incisions, most of the time that's a day surgery, and recovery is between 2 and 3 weeks. That doesn't mean you're laying in bed. No, you're allowed to walk around, you're allowed to do your stuff, but you're just recovering from your surgery. If we do fusions, then recovery is usually longer. I quote to the patient somewhere between 6 weeks and 3 months. Now driving, that's always a simple answer for me. You can drive when you feel you can drive. If you can move your back to the left and the right, and you can see the traffic around you, and you're not using narcotics, then you are allowed to drive with or without a fusion. Because if you get into an accident and those screws are coming out, that means something was not right, because those screws are so big and long, they should not come out, even if you get into a car accident. So that's my answer to driving. It depending on the patients and on how they are feeling.
Let's see, we've got a couple more. If you have been through multiple doctor's visits who indicated surgery is not needed, but even with PT and other non-invasive methods have not worked, is pain management the next step?
So I don't know why the other doctors obviously did not want to operate. Again, if you have the classic symptoms, sometimes you have people that have the classic symptoms and no real stenosis. That sounds weird. That's a possibility. So I really have to see, I have to hear the symptoms and I have to see the images. But now let's see the patient. You're right. There's no operative indication for any of these surgeries I talked about. Then you may end up with pain management, you may be a candidate for a spinal cord stimulator. I don't do those. Those are usually the pain specialists. But what they do is they put a wire up to the spinal cord, and that's connected to a battery. And that battery with the signals suppresses the spine signals, the pain signals going down the legs. And that's a way of treating it. Okay, so that may be an option, again, but I haven't seen the films and I don't know the clinical history here.
Is there still a role for chiroplasty or vertebroplasty?
Kyphoplasty. So kyphoplasty is used for patients that have a fracture. So they usually have osteoporosis, so bad bone quality, and they suffer severe back pain because suddenly they have a fracture of their vertebral body. What you do at that time is you inject cement to treat that back pain. Now, that collapse of that vertebral body may cause narrowing of the what we call the foramen. So the nerve that comes out may be narrow. In those cases, what I would do is I would put cement in to treat the fracture. And in those cases, if possible, I would do a small, what we call foramenotomy, so only decompress that nerve. I haven't discussed that particular type of patient, and because that's not a typical stenosis patient. They usually don't present with pain, with walking and standing. No, they have acute back pain. And they may have associated pain radiating down their legs. Now then, again, I would do cement and possible small decompression.
And then our last question is, do any of these processes pertain to foraminimal stenosis? And do you treat this type of condition?
So minimal stenosis, again, that sounds like a radiological diagnosis. If the patient with minimal stenosis has severe symptoms, I would treat it surgically. Because there are people that have what we say minimal stenosis, and they have all the classic symptoms at the right spot on the MRI. And then I'll tell them, well, I would still decompress it because I think you're a great candidate. So clinical diagnosis, number one, clinical diagnosis.
Perfect. Well, thank you, Dr. Pennings. We really appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah.
And for everyone, we have our next orthopedic webinar coming up in a couple weeks, October 14th, with Dr. Carlson. He'll be speaking about carpal tunnel syndrome. So if you have not already, please go to trinityhealthofne.org/events to register. And then coming up after the 14th, we have Dr. Daniel on the 28th, speaking about knee arthritis and then sciatica on November 11th, and then closing out our series is shoulder arthritis with Dr. Sprague in December. And then like Dr. Pennings mentioned, just some of the services that we offer in Springfield, you know, some of the procedures, conditions, spine conditions. So any questions, feel free to email Dr. Pennings or visit us on our website. And that concludes tonight's presentation. We hope you found it insightful and informative, and we hope to see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.